Hello there, all you amazing people. Today we are going to look at this tool here called NT-Lite that's actually doing a thing right now. Big disclaimer though, this can make your own Windows distribution / ISO, customize ISO, stuff like that. This is not a tutorial. If you don't know how to get a Windows ISO, if you don't know how to get this program, if you can't figure out how to use this program on your own, this is not for you. This is meant for IT professionals and not people that want to slim down Windows or want to take away telemetry just because they are like, oh, I hate this thing and it's the worst thing ever and stuff like that. This is not for idiots, okay? If you don't know what a lot of these things are that I'm going to talk about or have no idea how to figure out what they are, this is not for you. You are not there yet. So right now it's extracting the good old ISO here, putting it into a folder. If you don't know what that means, don't worry. This is not for you. It's basically making it accessible, editable. When it's done, I shall be back and we can look at it again. So this is what we are greeted with when it's all said and done. You know, we have edits down here. You can actually save edits here. You can presets or what you will call them. You can make a new one. So like if you do changes in here, it will basically autosave all the changes, or you can save the menu. So you can have different. Let's say you have to deploy like 10 Lenovo laptops of the same Lenovo laptop with the same configuration and all, you know, they need the same drivers and blah, 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 blah. You can save a preset called Lenovo T, whatever it's called, or Lenovo ThinkPad or whatever, and the same like Windows machines and stuff like that. So you can have a lot of presets here. Then you make an ISO for that specific thing. So just go briefly over the contents out here. So we have integrate. So we have updates here. What is really nice here is that you can see here, these are the ones that are on my system. So there's also drivers in here you can load in. You can go that back into that later on, but updates here. And we can actually go in here, which is really neat. You can get the latest updates online, and you can pick and choose. You put them in queue, and then when you do the ISO, it downloads it, install them, so you don't have to sit and wait for Windows abysmal fucking download times when it do updates. And here's the drive thing I talked about. Again, if you are installing, let's say, on tens, hundreds of computers, you can make an ISO for a specific computer configuration at your job that has all the drivers pre-installed and all of that jazz, and you do that in this section here. That means that if you take this ISO and you put it onto another system, there may be some drivers that you have installed that is not needed, and therefore some of the stuff may not work on that machine. Again, an IT professional understands that this is highly specific if you start to do the drivers, unless Windows Update will download the driver for you. If you really, 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 really want to go in and break Windows, you can go in and do registry edits. Some people would like to do that, you can do that, and we have a little bit of a post set up here. So before login, after login, you can basically put in programs you want to run, files, stuff like that. You have to understand a concept called unintended installs, and not all programs can do unintended installs. Chrome can do that, so you can put that, you know, in, so it will be installed while, you know, the ISO or while Windows being installed. Before the login, it can install Chrome for stuff like that. If you don't know what that means, if you don't know what programs that can and can't do that, this tool is not for you. You need to figure that out on yourself. This is the one that most people probably are going to mess with. It's basically components. What do you want to remove and not or have or keep or remove from your Windows ISO? Basically streamline the living shit out of it here. So you can remove Xbox, you can remove Xbox, anything has to do with Xbox. What I do with my work ISO that I use is to take away, you know, like Film, Cortana, Clipchamp, To-Do. They don't use that Solitaire. They don't use that Office. They do use Notepad, the Paint. They don't use that Power Automate. They use Quick Assist. You know, take away all of the shit that you don't need. And you can go really, really deep into this. These things are hidden because you need to pay for to do this. Some things are paid only, some are not. And some are locked down because they are essential for the system. And here you can take away, you know, it will support, hardware support, they have ISO images, they have localizations, multimedia, networking. You can mess a little bit if you don't want Telnet client. Most people don't want to use that, they don't use it. You can take that away. Remoting and privacy, you know, here peer networking, kernel debugging, system applications. Let's see what's in here. A call, app resolver, file explorer if you want to remove that one, file pick if you want to remove that one. Here, family features. If you can go nuts in here, and if you go into the system, you can go even more nuts in here. What you can do is you can click this little thing here called compatibility, which basically locks in features. So let here, Discord is ticked and unticked, so it's protected basically. and unprotected. It explains it here. Select which functionalities to protect, including machine support, hardware, and stuff like that. So let's say that you are a little bit iffy-diffy and you know what, I kind of want, you know, to protect Bluetooth or something like that, and you add that in here or some other things. Then if you by mistake remove something here, like, oh, this has to do with Bluetooth, you actually set here it what is depending on, but if you still do it, it will then be like, yeah, you can't do that because you have protected it, basically. Scheduling tasks, you know, you can set here the schedule of them. You can set it to remove. If you click here, remove default. And again, it will say that if you need to purchase it here, so it says here that purchase a new or renew an existing license. So I can't do that with the free version. And the paid license is not that bad, to be honest. This is also one that may be really interesting for a lot of people, is the feature thingy. You know, take away, remove features that you don't want. So here we have features on demand. You can, you know, include an old .NET framework. You can have Chinese, character recognition, Active Directory, lightweight directory service, containers, if you want to go into that data. Device lockdown, custom lock on. You know, you can really go nuts in here. Defender Guard, you can really, really go nuts. Settings. I think this is like features. This here configuration. Oh, sorry, this is the unintended here. Oh, we'll go into that later. Sorry, I'm going ahead of myself. This configuration is probably where people are spending most of their time. So this is where I will spend a lot of time. Here, you can do auto logging tracing. You know, can enable, disable a lot of that. Quest control, desktop. You can set access color. You can go in here and you can set search tab. Taskbar, this is by default icon. So instead, this is what I've done here. I have an icon. You can remove the here. So taskbar widgets. Disable, taskbar small icons, or taskbar size small, icon size, small icons, enable, and sometimes it will give you a little bit of a explanation here. Teams, I know a lot of people don't want that. Taskbar chat, disable that one. Taskbar alignment, so if you click here, no, that's the wrong one. Start layout, so I do more pins. Taskbar alignment, left, center, default, just keep it default. So hey, this is basically like, think about the look and feel. Here you can add desktop icons, this one you want. Desktop icon size, extra large, large, medium, small, I like small. Dynamic lock, again, you can easily fuck up your system here. So be aware of it. You can go pin to taskbar, you can, you know, notification center. You can disable that if you want. Notification network users, foreground logout, mouse menu delay, event viewer control. This is big, like this is massive. You know, here you can go in and explore here that we're in right now, autoplay, enable that one, CD burning features, if some of you have a CD burning, how to customize Explore. You know, you can customize how all of this looks with Explore. This is like, think of Arch Linux if you are Linux people. You can do that in here. Networking, you can go in here and go nuts with that. Power control. Fast startup, sometimes could be a good idea to disable this one. Hibernation size, what should be in the menu? If you want to remove, let's say you don't want hibernation on your laptop, so just for some, it can be security reasons, it can just be for some policy reason whatsoever. You just remove it from the start menu. Even if you are on a laptop that can hibernate, you just don't allow it. Privacy, this is probably one that a lot of people will go in and mess with. You know, allow telemetry, you can actually say disable, and it will give you a little bit of an explanation here. Correct misspelling words, clipboard history. If you really are paranoid, remove clipboard history. Cortana, disable that bitch. You know, go nuts. Let's Skype. You know, there's a way here. Pre-install OEM apps, pre-install apps. So like Spotify and all of these neat things in here, they will not be installed. You know, you can go in and remove all of the pre-installed bloatware, call it what you will in here. Shell bags, typing insights would probably be one if you don't have like a touch screen or pen screen or what you would call it. Turn that off. You can even disable smart screen. Yeah, smart screen if you want to disable that one for some reason. A really, really good one that a lot of people probably will go and mess with. But again, remember, you can easily break your system if you don't know what you are doing. So don't just click, oh, I don't like, you know, allow apps to access my camera. Then you're like, oh, why can't I use OBS Studio? Well, you disabled it. App list. What do we have? Extended, collapsed, hidden, default. App list, most used apps. Disable. I like to... I don't like that. I don't know why. I just don't like that my most used apps and recent apps, open apps are in my system. So I always disable these two here. You can disable folders, power button. Again, what it should be doing here. Show most used app. Where is it? It's here. Disable that one. Use tile. Disable. Whoop. Default. System. Page file. You can customize the living shit out of the page file. Setup requirement. RAM. Bypass the RAM requirement. Bypass the secure boot. TPM secure boot. bypass, you can bypass all of this. So again, that's what I did at work. I bypassed TPM and secure boot, and I bypassed the RAM check, so I can actually install it on really, 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 really low computer. You can even bypass the online Windows creation, like Windows. You can bypass remote desktop if you want to. Hey, a Microsoft account, you can bypass this one if you want to. I just do it in I think it's unattended or something like that. Let's go into services. Yeah, you can enable, disable services. If you have someone that you just, let's say their services you just disable by default. So a lot of us has services that we disable that we don't like running, or you want to enable them for that matter. Once you set them from automatically to manual, so when the program, when you start the program and then start to enable the service, you can do that in here. Like, you can really, really, really go down. Extra services, a lot of extra services, you know. Unattended, this is also probably one where people will spend a lot of time. Out of the box, on experience here, or unattended, is basically just streamlining the whole setup thing. So you can set the time, so you can even set OEM information. Yeah. So you can put in a logo, you can, you know, manufacturer. Oh, we need to enable it up here, that's why. There you go. I'm stupid. You can also save this and add account and stuff like so. What you can do here, which is really, really great, if you are again installing hundreds of computers or tens of computers that are using the same login, local login user account, you can put that in here. You can even put in the serial key for Windows in here, so it will always be activated. You know, I just forgot that I have to enable it because I'm stupid as a mofo. You know, we can set up system languages here. I don't know why. We could just go back to default here, I hope. There you go. Yeah. UI language, user local, time zone. Here again, the model. You want to set a model, we can do Bob here. Bob Linux. That can be the model. It would be automatically there in there. Support hour, support phone, skip the end user license, skip local account setup. I will not do that. Skip online account setup. I will probably go and say two to that one. A really good one is skip wireless, because a lot of laptops, you need to have the wireless driver installed before it actually works. Just, you know, it would say network location. Yeah, maybe not. I would recommend keeping these on, because it basically just can be a hassle to do. You can get it to work, but it's just more easier to just keep this like welcome center and stuff like that. And going to go fast privacy options. This is basically where you'd say it's like no to ink typing, sending data to Microsoft about your typing and data about your location and stuff like that. You can disable that in here also, but for the sake of simplicity, I just keep that on, because it takes like 5 seconds to say no to all of that. What a lot of times do is say skip local. I get it. I would say false, or just keep it unticked. Maybe I would skip the end user license agreement. Again, here you can set up the computer name. So again, if you call it Linux, we can do that. Activation key. You can plop in an activation key here. Registered owner and what have you not. If we go into like Windows PE setup options, Windows localizations again, UI. Again, we can skip the full name, computer prefix, product key. You can set in a product key in here also. I hope you can see the idea here. The whole thing about this is, you think of, if you know what OpenSUSE Tumbleweed or the YAST tool with OpenSUSE is, when you install OpenSUSE, you can go into, I think it's more options or something like that. You can customize the living shit out of OpenSUSE. That's basically the equivalent for Windows. This is going to apply. This is where you can go in here and you can basically go nuts. So you can also go in here and say like remove non-essential additions. There's no reason for your ISO to have, you know, let's say Windows Pro N if you're not using that, or Education, or Pro Education, and or Pro for Workstation, and N for Workstation. And you know, you see, you can't untick or tick the one off that's preloaded. So you can basically just, if you're not going to use any of these, just remove them, slim down the whole thing, and then you click proceed and it will go nuts. And like I said, when you click proceed, it will save you a preset, and you can create ISO here, preset here. We can save this one here right now and save as test laptop. So when you come back, you can then just load this up. You can do some modifications. You can save it again, override it and stuff like that. Bob's your uncle. It works. One thing I want you to do though, every time you made an ISO, run it in a virtual machine. What I mean by that, install it in a virtual machine to see if it actually are working, because you will untick something. I've done it multiple times. Like, yeah, I don't need that. And oh, fuck, I forgot that's depending on that and blah, 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 blah. So when you've made an ISO, start up virtual machine, install the ISO, and then just log into the system, click around a little bit. Maybe there's something. Oh, I forgot to remove photos or something like that. Or I forgot to move Xbox. Then go back and modify it. But every time you make a new ISO file, every time you go down and you do this here, create ISO, let's just save it there. Every time you do that, that every time you run this, install it again. You have to do a new install because there's a high chance that you can fuck something up. And Windows installs so fast nowadays that it basically takes like those 5 minutes is well spent installing Windows and then just logging in and see if everything is handy dandy. I hope this helped you out. See you all later. Bye bye.